Welcome to this video on finding maximum and minimum values of a function. As you can imagine, finding maximum and minimum values, together maximum and minimum are called extrema, because we often talk about them at the same time. So extrema is the word for either maximum or minimum. And finding those is a very important problem. To do so, we use the derivative of a function. And as you can imagine, in many applications, you want to reduce costs, which is finding a minimum, or you want to maximize profit, and then you have to find a maximum. And there are loads and loads of applications like that. And I will make a future video in which we will use this theory extensively, and we will see some fun applications. Now, let's see a short outline of this video. So first I will talk about higher order derivatives, which just means that if you have a function, you can differentiate it once, but you can also differentiate it multiple times. Then I'll present the derivatives of sine, cosine, tangent. You already know this from high school. And then we'll go into maximum minimum value. So we'll define them mathematically, and then we'll show how you can use the derivative, the first derivative, to find maxima and minima and to see whether a point is a maximum or a minimum. So that's a short outline of this presentation. First, higher order derivatives. So in a previous video, we have already seen that, for instance, if you're traveling by train, that you could make a graph where you put time on the horizontal axis, and on the vertical axis, you put the distance that you have traveled. We have seen that you would get a graph that would go, for instance, something like this if you're traveling. So here you're still picking up speed, here you're at maximum speed, and here you're reducing speed again. And you can tell that because we have seen that velocity, so the velocity of the train, v of t, is s prime t, so the first derivative. We have looked at this when we introduced the derivative of a function. Now, as you may recall from physics, you have distance traveled, then you have velocity, and you can also talk about acceleration, which is basically the change of velocity. So what that is the derivative of the velocity. So acceleration, here indicated with a of t, that is the derivative of velocity, v prime. And then if you go back, you see that we could also differentiate the original function s of t twice. So you could also say that a of t is the double derivative, the second derivative, indicated here with two primes, or d2 as dt. And you can also talk about the third, fourth derivative, and depending on the application, they have their usages. In more general notation, we usually write y is f of x, so we have a function of x. Then the first derivative we indicate with f prime, or and the second derivative with f double. The third derivative, still three primes, but then this notation gets a bit cumbersome. So you also see this, a superscript, and then three in between parentheses. And you can also fourth or fifth derivative. And there is also this notation with df dx, and then you see that the d gets a little 2 for the second derivative, and the dx gets a little 2 here. So just a different notation. It just means taking a function and differentiating it a couple of times. Now, you've already seen in high school that if you differentiate sine, you get cosine, and if you differentiate cosine, you get minus the sine. From this, you can also find the derivative of the tangent function, so the d dx of tangent x, that is the d dx of sine x over cosine x. And then if you compute it, so you use the quotient rule, you take the derivative of the numerator times denominator minus numerator times derivative of denominator over denominator squared. Let's do that. So if I differentiate a sine, I get cosine, times denominator is cosine, minus numerator, sine, times the derivative of d denominator, derivative of cosine, is minus the sine, so times minus sine of x. I can just squeeze it in here, over denominator squared, so that's cosine squared. So here in the numerator, we have cosine squared, and then we get a plus sine squared, and cosine squared plus sine squared is 1. So what we have is 1 over cosine squared x. So you see that with the standard differentiation rules that you already know, we have the derivative of the tangent, and I put that here as a corollary. So if you differentiate the tangent function, you get 1 over cosine squared. Now, something else that we will be using, and you can actually use it to find the derivative of sine using the definition of derivative that we have seen before with limits. I'm not going to show that here. But if you have this function, sine of x over x, you can see at 0 we have a problem because we have 0 divided by 0. Now, if you make a plot of the function using some software package, you get this. And you see that at 0, apparently, the function, if you have values very close to 0, they are 1. They are very close to 1. And in fact, you can prove rigorously, mathematically, that the limit for x going to 0 sine of x over x exists and equals 1. And we will encounter this a couple of times, and sometimes it's a little bit disguised. So you should know this limit by heart. And here are a couple of questions that you could try yourself. So the first 5 questions are on differentiation, so you can use these as a check whether your differentiation skills are up to par. And if you can see that once you've solved them, you can check your answer, because they're in black here, upside down, so that you cannot easily cheat. This one, I would like to discuss a little bit longer. So sine of 3x over x. So if you want to solve that question, so this one, of course, if x goes to 0, 3x also goes to 0. But I cannot immediately decide that this equals 1, and in fact it is not. So we have the standard limit from the previous slide, and let me write that a little bit differently. So from the previous slide, we know that if you have the limit of u tending to 0 sine of u over u, it goes to 1. So this is the standard limit, and we would like to use that also to solve or to find this limit. But the crucial thing is that the argument of the sine, so this u here, needs to be identical to the denominator. So you really want the same things there. Now, if we look at the question here, we see that we have the sine of 3x. So I would like to take u equals 3x. And then if x goes to 0, then of course u will also go to 0. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to rewrite the limit x is going to 0 sine 3x over x. I'm going to say this is the limit of x going to 0 sine 3x over 3x, because then I have that the argument of the sine and this denominator are identical, and that's what we need to use this standard limit here. But as you can see, I added a 3 to the denominator, so I also have to add that to the numerator. And now if you look, I added a 3 here, I added a 3 here, so they cancel out. I'm just multiplying with 1. And now I can say, okay, this is the limit of u going to 0 sine of u over u times 3. And then I have used the definition, I've chosen u to be equal to 3x. And then you see that apparently this is 1 times 3 equals 3. So that is how you can do these types of limits. if it looks a little bit like sine of something over something, and then the something should be identical, then you can use the standard limit. So keep that in mind also when you're trying to solve what it says here. So try to write this somehow into a form like this. Let me know if you do not know how to do this, and then I can maybe give more information. But I think it's best if you first try to do so yourself. So that was a little bit of a recap on things about differentiation that you have likely seen before, maybe not the standard limit. What I would now like to do is consider one of the main applications of differentiation, and that is finding maximum and minimum values of a function. So first, let's look what are maximum and minimum values. So here I have the graph of a function, and probably you will agree with me that the function has a maximum here and a minimum here. However, this thing also looks to be a little bit like a maximum, but not on the full domain, not on the domain from A to B, because the function is higher here. But if you would look more locally, say from here until here, so on this interval, then the function has a maximum here. And similar, the function has a sort of minimum here, but only locally. So we need some terminology for that. So we have a global maximum. So global refers that it is on the entire domain AB that we are considering. This thing here is called a local minimum, because there is another minimum, which is even lower on the full domain. But if we only look near this point, then it is a local minimum. Similarly, a local maximum and a global minimum. So I think intuitively, you fully understand now what this is. So how would you write this down in equations, or how would you write this definition down mathematically? Well, that goes like this. So I'm going to consider a function, and that function is in the plot here. So this is y is f of x. This is my horizontal axis. This is my vertical axis. And then it says here, so consider a point C. F of C is a global maximum, so something like this here. If f at that point C is bigger or equal f of x for all x, so whichever x you pick in this domain, f of C is always bigger or equal f of x. And the picture that I'm showing you here is a kind of standard situation, but you could also have, say, x-axis, y-axis. If you would have, for instance, a horizontal line on the interval A, B, then you see that every point, so for every point that I take here, the same condition holds. So apparently, at all the points in the interval, we have a maximum and a minimum. So that is also contained in this definition. This definition captures this behavior. And also, if your function would look like, well, something like this, and then it's smooth, and then like this, then all of these points where it's flat, they're all maximums. Okay. Then global minimum is similar, right? This is almost the same definition, only the sign has changed to less or equal here. And then how do we tackle these local extrema? So for a local maximum like we have here, what we say is still fc is bigger or equal f of x, but now x cannot come from the whole domain, but it comes from points close to this point C. So if I go down here, I have my point C here, and now what it says is that I have to find a little interval, so an open interval, that contains the point C. So I want the point C a little bit to the left of it, a little bit to the right of it. And on that interval, I want it to be a maximum. I want FC to be bigger equal FX for all the points in that little interval. So this interval I is an open interval. The endpoints are not contained. And C is in that interval. So a little bit to the left, a little bit to the right. And then of course local minimum is almost the same, but then only the sign swaps. So that is how you can write this down mathematically. And what is interesting here is that I just say that I is an open interval that contains C. I'm not telling how big it should be. So it can be any size. It can be like 1/100 to the left and 1/1000 to the right. As long as it is an interval, then it's okay. It doesn't need to have a certain size. It just needs to be an open interval of some size. So as I already said, we often talk about maximum or minimum and we find them in the same way. So the kind of container word for that contains both of them is extremum. So an extremum can be a maximum or a minimum. And then I will use global and local to indicate whether it holds on the whole interval or only at a point like here. You can also sometimes absolute and relative are also used for that. So absolute is global and relative is local. Now, as I said, finding extrema is often a very important problem that we encounter in many applications. So how to do that is interesting. And if here are a couple of bits and pieces on extrema and how to find them. First of all, are there any extrema? So do they exist? So if you have a continuous function on a closed interval, so now the endpoints are included, then so such a function will always have an absolute maximum and an absolute minimum. So that means that it makes sense to look for them. You know that they are there. Also, if a function has a local extremum at a point, then two situations can happen. Either the first derivative equals zero or it does not exist. So here you see a function that is nice and smooth and differentiable, and you see that for a local maximum or a local minimum, the tangent line is horizontal, and the tangent line is horizontal means that f prime c equals zero. And here, this is the absolute value function, for instance, you see that f prime c is undefined. We have seen that before, right? The slope of this line is -1, the slope of this line is +1, and here the derivative is not defined. So apparently, a local extremum can only occur if either the derivative equals zero or it is undefined. And that undefined situation, you can also have a function that looks, for instance, like this. So some kind of sharp angle. Now, if we are going to, this is what is mathematically called an implication. If we have an extremum, then this condition holds. It doesn't work both ways, but these points we can try and find. So what we will do if we are looking for extrema is that we're going to consider these points here, and we will call them critical points. That's on the next slide. And then we check whether there's an extremum there or not. So what we are going to do, first, these points are of interest, so points where f prime c equals zero or f prime c is undefined. We call them critical points. And then the statement is that if your function has an extremum, a local extremum, then it is a critical point, not the other way around, and we have seen that. But a critical point is a candidate for an extremum. So what we do, we find critical points and then check whether the function has a maximum or a minimum. And this thing that the reverse is not true, it's very easy to understand that. If you look here, so this is a function, for instance, x to the power 3 that looks like this. You see that it has a horizontal tangent line here at the origin. But there is no maximum or minimum, because if you go a little bit to the left, you get lower function values. If you go a little bit to the right, you get higher function values. So it's an inflection point or a saddle point. function goes both down and both up on each side of that point. So it's not an extremum, it's not a maximum or a minimum. So these critical points are candidates. There may be a maximum or a minimum there. It doesn't have to be like that. But they are a good way of finding extrema. So here is a recipe for finding global extrema. So say that we have a function that is defined on a closed interval AB. And then the question is to find global maximum and global minimum of f on this interval. And we have seen for a continuous function, so let's assume it's continuous, they exist, so it makes sense to look for them. So what you do is you compute the derivative. Next, you find the critical point, so you check whether derivative equals zero or where f prime c is undefined. So that would be these three points that you would find in this situation. You compute f, because we're looking for maximum and minimum. And if you're on a closed interval, it can also happen that the endpoints contain the maximum or minimum. As you see in this picture, the minimum, the global minimum, is at the right end of the interval. Because we only consider the function on the interval AB. So this here is A, and this point here is B. So we only consider the function on the interval from A to B. And as you can see, A and B are included. So you should have these. So for this picture, we have now found five candidate points. At those five points, we compute the function value. And then the largest function value found is the global maximum. The smallest is the global minimum. So that is how you can approach this problem. Now, what I would also like to do is I would like to use the first derivative to see whether we are talking about a local maximum or a local minimum. So how can we find that out if we do not plot the graph of the function? Now, to do that, we need to talk a little bit about increasing and decreasing functions. So a function that is increasing is something like you see here. If you go to the right, then the function values go up. So if you pick two points, x1 and x2, and x2 is to the right of x1, then fx2 should also be above fx1. So in the formula, a function is called increasing on an interval if when you pick two points in that interval, x1 and x2, with x1 to the left, x2 to the right, then fx1 is lower than fx2. That's increasing, of course. There is also decreasing. That's just the other way around. So for decreasing, if we pick x1 and x2 similarly, but now fx1 is bigger than fx2. Now, this is kind of hard to check for a general function. If I just give you a function that is a little bit complicated, then checking a condition like this, that can be kind of tough. So we can use the first derivative to do that. So what we can also say is if we have a function that is increasing, like you see in this picture here, if the first derivative is positive, then your function is increasing. And that is a lot easier. So if you have a differentiable function, you compute f prime, you check whether it is positive, negative, zero, and then you know if it is positive, the function f will go up, will be increasing. And similarly, decreasing means that the first derivative is negative. Now, then finally, we will use this to determine maxima and minima of a function using what is called the first derivative test. So what we are going to do is the following. So we have the following bits of information. We have a function f, and it is defined on a closed interval. We will assume it's differentiable. So the first derivative exists. We can compute it. And say now that we have a point where the first derivative equals zero. And what we would like to find out is, well, is it like an inflection point? So no maximum, no minimum. Or do we have this situation that we have a local maximum? Or third situation, do we have a local minimum? So we can find out by means of the first derivative. And three cases can happen. So we are going to make a sign chart of the first derivative. In case one, I have here a sign chart. So I have x and f prime. At x equals c, f prime equals zero. And, well, three situations can happen. So f plus can change from plus to minus. So to the left it is plus, to the right it is minus. And there can be more zeros, right? But I'm only talking about this one zero now. So I'm only talking about the point C plus the points directly to the left and directly to the right of it. The situation we have sketched here is that we have the point C. To the left of C, the first derivative is positive, which means that the function is going up. It has a horizontal tangent line. At C, because f prime c equals zero, and then to the right it's going down again. So you can see from the picture, so this is y is f of x. From the picture you can see that we have a local maximum. Next situation, we can have a sign chart like this, but then f prime not going from plus to minus, but from minus to plus. So that is this situation. So what we then have is, again, the function is going down to the left, it's going up to the right, and it has a horizontal tangent line precisely at x equals c, and you see that we have a local minimum in this situation. And then the last case is that f prime does not change sign. So here in my sign chart I put plus and plus. It could also be minus and minus. And that is either this situation, plus and plus, or you could also have this situation. So what you see here is that fc is no extremum. It's an inflection point, a saddle point. So no maximum, no minimum. So we can use this to find the extrema of a function. And I am going to conclude this video with two examples. So first example, find the extrema of the function that we have here. So what we should do is we have to compute the first derivative. Well, this is a polynomial, so that's not so difficult. 2 times 3 is 6, x squared, plus 9 times 2, 18x, minus 24. Then I'm interested to find where it equals 0, so I'm going to write it as 6 times x squared plus 3x minus 4. And you immediately can decompose this as x plus 4x minus 1. So you see that f prime x equals 0 is equivalent to x being either minus 4 or x being 1. And now we have to build a sign chart of the first derivative. Sign chart. So here below I put x, here above I put f prime x. At minus 4 and at 1 something special happens, because there it's 0. Now if I plug in a value here in between, so let's plug in 0, that's in between, then we get plus 4 times minus 1, so it's going to be negative. To the right here, let's plug in 1000, positive, positive, plus. And here to the left, let's take minus 1000, negative, negative, and minus times minus becomes plus. So apparently what we have for the function f itself is that it is increasing, going up here, it is decreasing here, and it's going up again here. Because the sign of the first derivative tells us whether the function is increasing or decreasing. So, increasing, decreasing, increasing. So apparently at minus 4 we have a local maximum. Local maximum f minus 4. And if you compute it, you will find it to be 102. That's just plugging in the value minus 4 at x equals minus 4. And here at this point, at 1, we have a local minimum. F minus 1, and if you plug that in, you will find minus 23 at x equals, plus 1 at x equals 1. Okay. So that is how you can do these types of problems. Compute the derivative, make a sign chart, read off the information from the sign chart. Let's do one more example, and that is this one, this function. So we have x to the power 5 over 3 minus 3 times x to the power 2 over 3. And if you plot that, then you see there is this cusp at the origin. So at x equals 0, this is perfectly defined. So if you plug in 0, you find 0. And you can also read that off in the graph. But apparently the first derivative does not exist there, because you see that the tangent line, if you come here from the left, would be something like this. The tangent line, if you come from the right, would be something like this. So it makes a jump there. So the first derivative does not exist at x equals 0. So let's try and solve this question too. And in principle, the solution method is the same. So we have the function f of x is x to the power 5 over 3 minus 3 times x to the power 2 over 3. So I'm going to compute the first derivative. F prime x is 5 over 3 x in the power 2 over 3 minus 3 times 2 over 3 x to the power minus 1 over 3. And you can already tell this thing does not exist for x equals 0, because then we would have division by 0. And we cannot do that. So x to the power minus 1 over 3, that is the same as 1 over x to the power 1 over 3. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to write this thing as x to the power minus 1 over 3 times, and then in between brackets we have 5 over 3 times. And then here we have x to the power 2/3. I'm pulling out this one. So then what I get between the brackets is just normal regular x. If you do x to the power 1 times x to the power minus 1/3, you find exactly x to the power 2/3. Minus 2, and then we just have a 1. So what you see from this relation here is that f prime x is undefined for x equals 0, then we have division by 0. And we have that f prime x equals 0 for 5 over 3 x minus 2 equals 0, which is the same as x equals 3 over 5 times 2, which is 6 over 5, like this. So now we can build a sign chart. So below we put x, up here we put f prime x. So always add this information, because you can build several sign charts. It can also be a sign chart of f, but here it's of f prime. So if you add that information, that's very helpful. Special points are 0 and 6 over 5. At 0, f prime is undefined, so I put a question mark there. Here it equals 0. And if you want to know the signs, so in between here, I could take 1, and then you see that we get minus. So we find a minus sign here. Then up here, I take a million, and then this is positive, and this is positive. So we get a plus. And to the left here, I take minus a million, and then we get negative times negative. And negative times negative becomes plus again. So what you see is, if you would add the information for f, you see that it goes up, down, up. So we have a local maximum. Local maximum f 0 equals 0 at x equals 0, and we have a local minimum f 6 over 5, and that's an ugly expression. I'm not going to simplify that, at x equals 6 over 5. So then we have the information that we wanted to know. Now here I just put a couple of examples with general functions that have no interpretation. In the next video, I will show a couple of fun applications on how you can use this for applications where, for instance, you have you need to do some packaging, your Amazon or bol.com or whatever, and you have to send a certain volume to a customer and you want to reduce on packaging. So you want your packaging cost to be as low as possible. So how can you make the area of a box, say, as small as possible, where still you have to contain a certain volume? Those types of questions we can also do now. So the next video are going to be a couple of fun applications. Let's wrap up this video. So what we have seen is first that you can differentiate a function more than once. And the interpretation can be if you have distance traveled, velocity, acceleration. We have defined maxima and minima, so global and local extrema of a function. Then we have studied how you can find candidate points of where an extremum can occur. And then we have used the first derivative test to see at a point whether it's a maximum, minimum, or not an extremum at all. So that concludes it for this video. Hope you liked it, and I'll see you in the next one.